Hello, music of Winy on. Hello all, good afternoon, welcome. It's a big pleasure today to host Winy Maas. Very little to say about him. Winy is a good friend from the past, a more frequent visitor the last couple of years. He's now also a guest faculty at IAAC in the Master in City and Technology, and together with some of you, the students, he have been working on this kind of futuristic vision of a robotic city. He's director of the and co-founder of the MVRDV, with amazing built and unbuilt work all over the planet. He's one of those very few architects that, in my opinion, has the capacity to work successfully in different scales, from very small objects to buildings to master plans and urban strategical design. And I think that is very much to be complimented. And he's also the director of the Y Factory at the TU Delft, a research platform where he is envisioning together with students and professionals what is the future of the city. But with different projects from his office and his research, I think that he's always trying to deal with the complex local conditions from the grand, from the vision for the Grand Paris project, where he was really trying to propose merging ideas for the most sustainable and one of the most dense cities in the world, but also to buildings such as the Market Hall, where he merges programs and uses in an innovative architectural language, but also one of my favorite ones, which is an unbuilt research, which is the WeGo city. I always call it do-it-yourself city, but the idea of how a city could be based on the person and how the person can adapt the environment that surrounds him. He has been always drawing a line of what is next, and he never stops asking what's next. So, a very strong player in the contemporary architectural field. It's my pleasure and my honor to have you here with us. And please help me welcome Winy Maas.
Thank you, Arezi. So the good thing about being back is that I don't have to show the last things of the last year. So, and I do that with certain institutes in the world, so you are one of them, but it's also the AA and in Colombia that I'm regularly, hopefully, to attend. So let me, but that doesn't mean that I bring as hopefully a good lecture to remind you on the last part and to bring it from there one step further. Hey, I take you to Rotterdam for a moment. You know Rotterdam, some of you. It looks kind of bold and like a strange collection of buildings. It used to be cute, say Barcelona, and it and then of course everyone remember this. So what was next was this flattening out action, and that has cost for Rotterdam an incredible, say, courage to make, I think, one of the most beautiful and boldest building on the planet. The building of Maaskant, one of my favorite architects, that I that made a series of objects that on first look worse than Le Corbusier, but when you come closer, it beats him by far. So I would like to invite you for that. And that's actually, so what Rotterdam does, of course, is continuing with an urbanism that is basically made out of objects. And normally, if I would say talk with American critics, then they would hate it and they would say there is no cohesion, which is not true. Every building, every generation talks to the former one and adds to the collection in a very nice way, I think, even in a very intelligent way, maybe a hidden way in that way what it wants to do. And it does it in of course in a range as Rotterdam is, in a bold, very multicultural way, and it continues with that. And that's the thing that I want to talk about now to start, because maybe some of you have looked this morning on the web what happened. I made a small sketch, one moment, because we are celebrating in Rotterdam this year the 75th anniversary of what we call the wederopbouw, the reconstruction of the town. And what is nice, what we suggested with the sketch, is to add an extra layer to the town. What's next, indeed? The tweederopbouw, the second reconstruction, is what is happening by simply just a stair that you add to a roof, and then hopefully people are going to climb. So these are images of yesterday, how it is now now there, and how it simply contributes now to a kind of, I didn't expect it either, that there would be like 1,000 people per hour now, so which is like three times much as the fire police want to have, and how it's now getting and it turns into a kind of device, basically, where people start to train, and where they want to climb up as rapid as possible. And somehow, suddenly, this whole dream of having a kind of city where, say, we would not have heart attacks, but that we would like somehow want to be faster, is what this element is showing in a way. So there are small films that somehow show this mob going up and going up endlessly on this element, and that makes me somehow like vulnerable also, that simply an element like that could work, and that you can add that next layer of a town, so that somehow a lot of people love suddenly our city and have this kind of overview. That is what such a device can bring, and that is the subject of today, I would say, to span the gap, I would say, from small to big, that we can, where is the image there, this would, where we can somehow think about like a city that uses everything what is possible, that can be connected everywhere where possible, and that even the smallest object, I mean, this thing doesn't cost more than €300,000 to have that then in on this place, and then somehow starts to activate this monster, this beautiful monster of Maaskant with activities like that. And also today, with the recent Facebook elements, I got that picture again. Of course, this is once more, I know, and it actually was born in Barcelona at a certain moment, when we made this kind of sketches at a certain moment, that your Cortes Inglés, which is somehow a stupid building here on the Plaza de Catalunya, which deserves a connection with that roof and could activate and behave like a tribune at the most nationalistic moments of your epoch. So can we not get that done now after having built this? So I'm dreaming at the moment of a Rotterdam that is hyper-connected. This is not a good building, as you know, but it starts to become better if we add that to it. This is also quite cute, but we have to use the roof. And this is also quite okay, but yes, also there we have to continue. The theater is a stupid box that deserves further definition. The library looks like Centre Pompidou, but deserves better. And of course, our Cortes Inglés is what I would love to add to that, to you. And then we can continue with bridges that span out, that even REM is not obnoxious anymore, and is helping with the next generation to go on with this exercise. And also the classics could be included in that manner in any way. Even the hippest, say, spots of Rotterdam could turn into somehow a kind of beauty. And yes, every twin set can then be connected. And of course, in the end, I also I give our building also to that enterprise. This is about architecture and the city. A special request by Areti not to talk too much about robotics, because you are already drenched by it and drowned by it, so that in a way to talk about urbanism and how it relates in a way to its products, its architecture. Here and there in this lecture, I will give you some of the logic behind it and about the parametrics behind it, since your school is seemingly specializing on that. You know that I love cities, that's clear, because they have density and they want to be dense, and for many reasons, more space, more interaction, more symbiosis, but of course there's a next generation of logics of that intensity. And there's like a shopping list that I would like to add to our cities in order to make that qualities better. Yes, green should it be, obviously. Yes, diverse, because more and more I think we are a city of diversity in that way. Yes, also specialistic. Barcelona should be different than Amsterdam. Please do. Yes, it should be energetic, because it has to create somehow energy from you guys that have to be to beat us. And intense or dense, no problem at all. Accessible, obviously. I follow here, one could say, Rousseau, in a way, how that should be done. Historic, obviously, no problem I have with heritage commissions. We just overwhelm them with interpretations as such and behave almost like Troy, where we add layers, as I did in Rotterdam. So a new layer on our fabric. So you can continue in a smart way. And of course, it has to be lovely, beautiful, free, exciting, and in the end, of course, democratic, because that is what I'm about. Democracy is not a bad thing, because if you want to do and think about urbanism, then the 50% rule is there. You have to gain more than 50% of the voters in order to activate what the future can be. So I know we are not making referendums at any moment, or only in Switzerland a lot have a good tradition on it. And some of us doubt about the referendum system because it doesn't function in European states. Still, I do think that somehow we have to find a way to say that even the most, to work on conviction in that way, and that create the next set of generation. So how to show that? These words, this shopping list. And I take you to three examples, three levels. Research, urbanism, architecture in the end, to kill it off, one would say. So what is about research? I do it only short because of the request to add in some of the parametrics that we are doing. The Y factory has already been introduced by Areti, and this is the image of it. This is how students are sitting on it, and they are more close than you, actually. That's what it, because you are far away there, and it makes it, why don't we make some to here, and then we produce, of course, as you produce. We had a discussion this afternoon at the TE that you have to produce. Thinking is partly it, but also you have to show to us that it's convincing, and that makes also to publicize it, to get knowledge from you. I'm expecting that from you in your way, and then we can discuss it and then show these products over the world. So we are indeed working on a series, and these series are about the future city, and they have on one end they are like a model city. They are very abstract, only 1 million people, and then work it out. I'm happy to announce that with some of your institutes here in the city, with Creal and others, we are working on the healthy city in that way, to imagine, say, how epidemics can be combined with urbanism, or mean that urbanism can kill epidemics in that way. And I'm proud on that, because I do think that there's more in urbanism sometimes than we can explore in architecture. There's more width. It's not only parametrics, don't worry. It's also, there are more fields to discuss, and I'm super happy with Creal in that way to perform that, if that can go further. The next thing, of course, beside the model city, is of course to apply it on certain situations. Not too long, I always say to Areti, maximum 30%, because otherwise you are dredged in Beirut, or you are dredged in Hong Kong, or you're dredged in all these places that you are visiting, but you don't abstractize, you don't make it global, you don't make it more theoretical as such, and you are a place to do it. And last, in the end, the project starts in the fall, is the controller, where all the parametrics come together in a software. And the Space Fighter is an old one that we made, and this City Max adventure, starting in August, is the next one that we are facing. So these are some of the books I'm not going to mention about leadership. The Badass Copy Guide comes out soon in the end, which is of course a bestseller, because everyone wants to learn from everybody. Still, I love this entry of this competition that we lost dramatically, of course, because how can you do that in the US, to copy the born place of copy paste? But if you do that on that in with Sarine, then you will be of course excluded. Irony in and US are two different words. So and that is I'm happy to be back in Europe to reveal with you irony, because that gives us a certain kind of survival act in bad times. So what is next? Some of you might know the word Green Dream in one of the older books. Still, to mention it, because when you are working in your new program, unlike products that can make better cities, which I think is very good that you start to do that, then I would like to mention some of them. Not these observations, but the observations were part to make, say, a better calculator of, and that would beat Braham and Leed, which are two stupid calculators at the moment that don't talk with each other, that have nothing to do with grand scale, and are obsessed with say, the technology of building only. And that is so that deserves not only a calculator, also then an example of the greenest city that we made with that and that book, and it looks like this. And you will say, boring Dutch in that way. Very systematic, and what can we learn out of that? So to combine that somehow with a Southern European touch of flavor, we work, and we still work at the moment with the Wine Factory on what we call patent branding. You have patents, there are so many. Just go to IPO and you see how many patents there are only in Europe. And if you pick out some of them that are still useful, and those are people that are 92, 95, live in Braunschweig or other ugly places in Germany, and that they but they have fantastic ideas. Simply enlarge them, like this one, this crop rotator at the moment, big salad goes like this, but that's only 1.50 meters. If I turn it into 9 meters, I have more production. But how to do that with robotics, with all your stuff, then I can do that very beautifully, and then our roofs can be really like fantastic elements, and then your ensanche will be of course much nicer, and the super blocks will be three-dimensional, is what I would say. This continues also with the hollow stones, that where you can harvest basically dew in a specific conditions. Yes, that would be great in Beirut or in Cairo to have that, and to we try to propagate that, especially for Egypt now, to get some of them tested on that in the deserts. Or this one, this gel that is somewhere also in your stuff, where water suddenly becomes beautiful, where microbes start to glow, and then you can make indeed pictures that are more beautiful than Walt Disney's enterprises. And last but not least, these students are, because I love them, that they now make it, they get now money out of that, to have this patent, this movable solar farm, and but they made this connected with these images, and then, as I said last time, Avatar has been beaten, and suddenly we are eager to get it, and we were hungry to obtain it. This accelerates that city. This objects, this is architecture, I would say, because this helps suddenly to convince everybody to go on. So we can speed up with our green discussion, so that, say, in a couple of years we don't have to talk about sustainability anymore, because I'm quite fed up with that. So what's next on this level? So just for the sake of the argument and sake of the special quest to add in again parameterization, I show you porosity, why the book comes out and new things are done in that process. I want to show it also that you cannot do everything in one studio, so you have to accept as students that of course you do a studio, the next studio has also, basically for every research I need more or less like 4 studios and two and a half year of editing to make it doable. This is shown in this one because it's about a kind of protest action against this stupidity that we call towers. The towers, you go in, go up and back again. They have nothing to do with urbanism. They are simply solitudes on a kind of tabula rasa. And I do think that this deserves action as such. Maybe some of you remember this Lego towers that we made, and the most beautiful one was actually when this happened, when you open them up. Why opening up? For many reasons. To give a world for birds, to cool the tower, to have social spaces, maybe to have access to many places. And initially we asked students, No, that doesn't work. This is the new PowerPoint, it's horrible. Yeah, there it comes. A bit quick, but that's how it is. So here, students did one element. Add, for instance, open up your belly, this pregnant tower, and then gradually, step by step by step, piece by piece by piece, it becomes more expensive, but also better. So that every student did something. The twister. One twist, two twists, three twists. How much does it cost? Or what is this one? Oh yeah, the ball maker, like neighborhoods. How many can I afford, is what he or she is asking. Or the cactus maker, that splits this into more facades, so that there's more access to all your rooms in that way. And how many can add for a certain price, for a certain amount of, say, costs. That is a logic that we put into a series. From here, the balconies, from nothing to many, or here, say, from no space to maximum space, or here, from no balconies to a lot, or the deviation series, the landscapers, and the parasites. And if you put them together, then you have this landscape of towers. And I'm still proud on it. I mean, I took them, of course, to Venice, and I took them to other places to show that this sequence of towers are somehow beautiful. If Manhattan would look like this, then we would have a scientific research on towers. If the Ensanche could be maybe redesigned, I would have done this somehow to use it as an exemplary mode of testing different variables, not studying the, say, identification or like similarization, but differentiation as such. So what do I see here? Here the pregnant towers over there. Here the ball series from no space to maximum space. Here the balcony sequence, how they are made by the neighborhoods, and my favorite one, the polite tower, where I can walk over the stairs, over the house, from the bottom to the top, that's recompensated by its own weight. I'm waiting till this will be copied. This is so I expect some of you that will do that, so you're free to do that. I will come back to you, of course, afterwards. And here's some others that are done. The question is, what's next in that way? So what we did here, use your intuition and that moment, and I want to add this. And then you get this sequence. And then you scripted it, because you analyzed the parameters it, post-scripting. Can we do the inverse, pre-scripting? I guess you do this every day here at the school, this kind of controversy, but give me an example. So in the case of stairs, using houses as stairs, these are the variables that are connected like that, that are demonstrated in this section, where in that way the houses are used, different angles, different fire codes, etc. And then I get, in a certain optimization, these kind of examples are that. So I can walk from the bottom to the top, it becomes better than Escher, and I have a gorgeous tower. Wow, this would have been nice instead of this building next to the Glorias, that to have somehow a point that I could go up. But or the landscapes one, that starts with these parameters, that makes this kind of floors of trees. And yeah, where are the columns, is what you say. Yes, so we connect them in that way, or they connect them. And if you add structure components in it and mass, then you get this equation out of it. That means basically that I make grottos from where I can walk from one to the other, and leads to a tower that's, wow, this is public. This is adding to it. Did I talk about Rotterdam, about the stairs? Now suddenly I try to parameterize that. That's what it, so, and that leads them to these compositions, and that continues. Any example of the students that made it, made this kind of series as such, and some of them are super beautiful and super appealing as such. So use again this, yeah, this combination of beauty and parameterization to judge your products in that way is what is wanting to ask. So what's next afterwards? Now we are working on the calculations. And I will show that in, I think, about September, October, to show the calculations in the new book of how much steel do I need with a stress factor to look in a relative and in an absolute way, and then see how much cost these things are costing and how much benefits is coming out in that way, and that leads hopefully to a next exercise. Can I continue? Yes, I was talking about urbanism on special requests. So here you see how students recently worked on urbanistic compositions with that parameterization, with this different. So here's some examples, a starting point, patios, say an Arabic system, how it would look like with maximization of difference, or slabs, how that can lead to an incredible richness, or how the kissing act of towers can lead to certain compositions, or the thinning aspect, that we dream all about this kind of, say, different thinning that could be done, and of course, Constant would be also there. One of my favorite artists ever made on the planet, who helped to dream about these connections. And that's what next. But what's next? I need you guys. Because now I can never make any Lego exercise anymore. Because I need for every tower 3 students, 3 weeks, day and night. And they will kill me, you kill me, that's all. So yes, we do need now this kind of elements. We do collaborate with Los Angeles to have that done, and we concentrate on the parameterizing, is what ultimately the sublime moment, I would say, to use a French word, to make this exercise, to finish this exercise, if it's ever finishable. Next chapter. Give me a second, because this takes a minute. I take you now, after this, say this research discussion on urbanism. And because this is the main topic of today. I know urbanism is boring. And mostly you have, and there's actually not so many sexy urbanists on the planet. Jan Geel, okay, sunny pavements are fine. Albert Speer, they wouldn't dream about such a kind of elements. Who else, please tell me, some landscape architects are doing it, dressing it up a bit landscape, very fine and fair. I think Adrian does a good job in his theoretical world. But we need more, basically. Because why are we all talking about cities and no one is taking the responsibility or leadership to make it one step further? So somehow I do think that we have to train urbanists that are not only talking about rules and planning and yawning about what that can be. No, to visualize it, to make it sexy as such is what we try to do. So how can we do that? Let's start with from the beginning in this case. Just start with Europe for a moment. And a small enterprise that we did for the European Union to say what is so European about Europe. And if you make pictures like this, then the beauty of Europe is that it has 450 towns that are 100,000 or more. It is a collection of cuteness that we all know, and that's quite okay, I would say. It's quite expensive when you compare it to Rio or to other clusters, but somehow it works. Why does it work? Because it can maintain the largest amount of history, and it can also help that, say, small entities, small mayors, can work on ideal compositions. I mean, mayors love this in Europe. Castle, some cuteness, and then, of course, they walk, they want us walking, which is, I think, is fair to do it. Then the rest is putting into metro systems. Tramways are super hip in Europe, and every year also now, two tramways. I'm looking forward, if you can afford it, to make it, and and the rest of us is going to bike. And then the rest is green, and okay, the whole list, that is Europe at the moment. That's not Europe, that's 40% Europe. Because the majority of Europe is this, and we call it quite shit in that moment. Eh? And it always, this is my favorite slide, which celebrates the Lidlification of Europe, and that somehow we sell it out, or it's Primark or it's Lidl, that we are somehow dealing with. How to deal with that? We made maps of all the cities in that way to show in green what is the most expensive and in red what's alarmingly red in that way. And they have all basically the same maps, all the cities. So we love the slides that I showed before and we hate the second park. That gives us a task to do. Very clear, very doable. So, but then at a certain moment, they asked us to compare it with the US. And of course, you know the US has this kind of horrible centers. Then it has the nicest roads of the planet, where you don't want to. But all roads end in cul-de-sacs, which is, I think, very symbolic of the thinking in urbanism in the US. Well, they want to catch up. So these are the recent, say, designs and developments. If you go to Asia, a raw urbanism of infrastructure and brutality as such is recently, of course, compensated by, say, this is Nagasaki and not Amsterdam. This is Shanghai and not Copenhagen. And this is Nanjing and, not Malmö at that moment. So somehow, we have a selling product here. Somehow, if we talk about urbanism, there is anyway the successful part is in the European factor at the moment. So let's see if that works. If there are, because that's the meso level, I would say. Still, we do not work very correctly on the mega cities as such. Still, we do not work very good on the giant landscapes. Still, we do not work on the outer skin of the planet. Let's keep this for a moment in order to introduce a certain sexiness on the planet. And then I want to show that in a kind of certain kind of project. You are referring to Paris. Let's have a look. We had a good client. First Sarkozy, then Hollande. And they were talking about, like, what can we do? This is Paris, cute, beautiful, very. And then the other 95% is, yeah, looks like shit, basically. It's just like endless periphery, many riots, and I can't find my way through it, always. It's even after 15 years of work now. At that moment, because you might think, is this going to happen? So that's why I want to show it. Sometimes things take longer. So you all want to become architect because then you can build in 3 months what you want. and that's and urbanists take slightly longer. I like it still. I will not say that I concentrate only on Greater Paris. I show you tonight that it's good to have more balls in the air that work parallel to many commissions in order to get your spirit going. So this one is referring initially to post-Kyoto, and we made these graphs. What are the challenges of our city and why do we need cities? We do, and that this campaign has now been taken over by Anne Hidalgo, the recent mayor, fantastic woman, who wants to do more instead of less. Because less was this killing act of the recent generation. We have this, all these hipsters in every city that say, yeah, let's go into old buildings like here and we can do less. Let's all let's do less things and all small buildings. I find it a super sympathetic operation, this kind of happy bricks generation. But is there all there is? At what moment do we need somehow to think about a larger scale? So I'm waiting for a flood of hipsters and a flood of this bottom-up cuteness, so that at a certain moment there is a scarcity of big-scale thinkers, and that will come up. The second gift, the first gift we gave to Sarkozy and to Hollande was a calculator. I know it's not poetic to give someone a calculator and for his birthday, but I think it was good to somehow imagine at that moment how good Greater Paris is. This is I show this maybe for some of you for maybe the second time or the third time. Repetition is not bad, is that to somehow show the method of getting an agenda, getting the 50%+. So the performance of Greater Paris with this calculator was nice, because density was very low compared to, the tourism was okay with Euro Disney, the density of work was alarmingly bad, and the participation in the public transport was surprisingly low, even with the good traffic in the RER system, and Grand Parisians love their car, almost the same level as Los Angeles. So this was an eye-opener in that way, that gave a kind of score that we could compare with other cities, and it created at that moment an ambition, a program. Say 2030, we would be the best, we want to be the most sustainable, as Aretti was saying, then I need this amount of forests to compensate current Paris. Then I need this extra for energy spaces, this amount for access, and this for another kind of habitats. Our habitats are not that good in that way, and have to fulfill more porosity, as I explained before, or to have more economical activities. So this was the second gift, this cadeau that would then open up, like in Independence Day, in that way, over Paris, which I can then start to repair. Now architecture comes in, because this amount of trees is now happening with the national forest southwest of Greater Paris. That takes a while. How much does it cost? How much do we have to change in the agricultural land to make this national forest? And I'm happy that that's one of the outcomes. Or this energy element, which is also now coming out in two parts. Yes, a wind park, or in the Palais de Saclay, in the Plateau de Saclay, where this kind of block of windmills is coming very soon. And also to have that this law at the moment that every roof should be covered with solar cells is simply applied by the government. I'm happy to have a president as a client, so that becomes easier to get that through, is what this is basically showing. And of course there are other things. I mean, there are also private obsessions from me, like you have. In this case, I'm obsessed by this stupidity in France, and that every train ends in Paris. If you take the train from the north, at Thalys, I go to the Gare du Nord, it takes me 2 hours to go to Gare de Lyon to get a train again. This is insane. This is elitist. And I'm aware with your new strategies here in your city, so you're doing the same. Eh? All cars end in the super blocks so that you don't go further in the future. I'm not sure if that is the case. With public transport, I find it stupid. So the project to connect these lines, shown in these slides, which in a way come together in Place de la République, of course, and that is I think a nice further study. I don't know if I managed that in that way, but to have already the first studies to do that, to do the calculated trains, the standing time, the waiting time in that way, to calculate the costs of one pipe underneath Paris compared with a rocade, with a kind of line that goes via Versailles, which I think is completely stupid, is still, I'm happy they accepted it. So yes, you can come up with ideas, is what it wants to show. And then the rest, that's not interesting to show. I mean, of course, we have to do something about the banlieue. I will come back to that later in another city to give that detail in that way, how to make that differentiated. And yes, also Haussmann solidaire, by raising one floor up, we can have so much tax income that I can pay one metro line in that way, is what it says. And yes, now Oslo later is also taking that over. I will show that in a minute, how that will be done there. So these are then all the ingredients. There are 39 pieces that has been developed by different architects that are come together on this map. This is the new structure plan of Greater Paris. And how, if I calculate then what the effect of it is, I don't need all of them. I can make Greater Paris plus petit. That's what it actually says. And of course, as a Dutchman, I love this controversy between between big and small, and like a Calimero, to think about Paris as such. So that's the first exercise about a European agenda to imagine, or an urbanistic agenda. How to make that, how to calculate that, what is the good and the bad about that? Not this kind of vague sketches that are somehow, not this kind of only about lines, green lines. That's not the issue only. I think there are much more in urbanism to think about, even the larger scale to think about. Let me now take you to Bordeaux. Bordeaux is close by here, so that's this is a very vulnerable picture, but it's like our urbanists have to talk. So in architecture, you can simply do what you want. You have a little bit of talking, especially in China. But in urbanism, 40% of my fees go to talking, and in France, 55% of it, because they talk longer. So that's, here you see an example of that, how to do that. So yeah, how to become an efficient talker is basically also a challenge to do. But I show you the examples of the beauty of talking in that way, of communication. This is Bordeaux. This is the first site that we're going to make. Bordeaux is bobo, it's très bourgeois, and it loves itself, basically. But if you go then to the bridge, the Garonne, and I look over the Garonne, then see on the left bobo Bordeaux, and so it's UNESCO and highly protected, very beautiful, don't take me wrong. And on the right hand, you see a contemporary French bad architecture, ruins from Napoleon, villages over there, and again, bad French architecture. So how to do that and to conquer, basically, and this is a decision, you can do other decisions, I'm aware, but here, with Alain Juppé, decision is taken to conquer Rive Droite. Okay, what would change the model of Bordeaux from, say, an anti-city to a very European city? It looks almost like Paris. This is Paris Plus Petit, what do we say, or Grand Bordeaux in that way. And we could start to formulate together before we make any image. Because there is a problem if you start images of like what the city would look like, it is so boring, end up a discussion. But everyone wants to be dense, no problem. Who is against patrimoine and who is against heritage in that way? No one. Who is against mixture? Ooh, I don't hear protests in the audience. And who is against some kind of humanity, intimacy, is what this wants to say. Hi, Willy, welcome. Here's a seat for you. You missed the general part, but that's, you know it. So and this diagram was helping so much. It convinced many people to immediately to go, I will show you the consequences, because I have to change the French law. It has to be green, but not competing with the Grand Garonne. Le Grand Royal. No, it has to be mignon in that way. It has to be, of course, energetically neutral, minimally giving. It has to be connected with tramways, and it has to be lumière du jour. Everywhere, sun should go to the lowest parts. I want to live on ground floor, which is, and not only shopping. So this is the first part of this enterprise, and I don't show you the other parts, where indeed this tramway is coming in, where with a colleague we are making this glass bridge that can open itself in a gentle way without, say, pushing UNESCO too much. But the main thing is this, if you have such a kind of friche urbain, right, and then what is now historic. Can you tell me what is good about these buildings? So the rails are also nice. I mean, I wouldn't mind to have rails in my home in that way. Or platforms, are they bad? Or hangars? So we said, okay, we accept them all as a plot and plot definition, and then surround it with an offset which we call roads, 6 meter wide, super cute, so that you can walk around, a bit barrio gotico in that way. And how to do, and then the rest is extra plots. Then I make something which is somehow more beautiful also than Ensanche, because it's somehow, it's so full of surprises. It's 50% of public space, cute, everywhere, and it looks a little bit, there's also a challenge, which I would have loved that it would have been in the super blocks, in the discussion, to have everything like shared space. You didn't decide, you made a hierarchy of big blocks and smaller elements. But this is nice to compare, because shared space is at the moment maximum 3 hectares. Then traffic engineers don't know how to calculate it anymore, how to navigate through it. There is no hierarchy anymore. What is chaos? Is chaos good? Does it lead actually to self-ordinance in that way? Is what this is, and so this 35 hectares is the enlargement of, say, within French rules, to make a shared space of that size. And then I don't need everything, so I can use it also for usage of people in that way. But then what comes then? Next, tramways. Normally every tramway needs to be next to the tramway that returns. Forbidden to separate them by law in Europe. So stupid. Because it's very not dangerous. It is very dangerous. Where's the tramway coming in that way? It is. It blocks huge parts of the streets in that way. So because of the fact that we could make the law in this case first start with 6 meter roads, the problem was there. So we had to split the tramways. Of course, Alain Juppé, next president maybe, is also very helpful to change laws. So yeah, we need leadership to get that done. But it's there, and then you start to build. This was too much. Really, you can't do that. It was no, okay. The trimming action, 45 degrees, living on ground floor with sun, is actually fantastic. And immediately started to communicate, this is European town. And all the plots are different. There is no one equal in that way. So inequality, woo, liberté, fraternité, egalité, was a kind of interesting discussion to monitor. Of course, it has to apply on Bordeaux standards, 22 degrees. We trim it even more, and then some other kind of small elements are added to that. We added small gardens, and then 144 architects are working on it at the moment. Of course, the cores have to be opened. We have to add natural ventilation. We do some adjustments, and we add solar panels over the roof everywhere. And we embed them in vegetal components, and so that there we can catch the water, bring it down to the sockles. And I must say, France is much more advanced than the Dutch in having a kind of transparent soil, so that indeed it can accommodate the future of the Garonne, even on the lowest floors. Implication of, say, the fact that water is going under our buildings, there will be many rats and many mosquitoes. So how to deal with that is also part of our operation to deal with that. So happily, we are working on that now. So this is what the project is, how we abstractize it, how we extruded it, cut it more, adjusted it, give it to the authors, and add it to the pocket parks. And in the end, of course, with the solar panels and the vegetation, and then we are ready. And somehow we make a kind of roofscape within the city. Somehow it echoes Bordeaux. And that's what we're talking about today. Eh? How can every city be special? How can I then also translate that into a logic that even in 20 years, my sons or all the French designers can apply to that? That is what we try to do in this way, and then change it to that. These models help, of course. They communicate it, giant models of polyurethane, so that we can somehow convince that it has cute roads, that has beautiful scapes of roofs, and that the roads are indeed very human as such. And of course, in the end, this bridge this symbolizes connected or not to connect it. That's of course a choice that the inhabitants will do, and we take it from there. So these are two examples of urbanism under, say, European conditions, or say trying to make that European agenda more clear. I take you to a next example. I take you to Amsterdam for a moment, because I didn't talk about green and in that way. So I give you then also an example of super green. I will kill you with green, is what we are going to do. because it's Almere. Almere is on the right side of the slide. Amsterdam is beautiful, rich, and then they designed this city to get rid of the poor and put them there. It was basically the exercise. They did it in a kind of nice way with garden cities. And this is the production of that homes, average price around 180,000 euros, and with which, yeah, this was a stupid action, of course, to do it. So what to do? An update on that city. How to get more out of Amsterdam and make this better. First act what we did, we declared the structure plan as holy, as a UNESCO protected element. Why? Because this is very characteristic. Maybe it's not, of course, the green in between is horrible, and you are raped before you are to the next, to the city, but on the other hand, the ideology is good. Maybe we can make an illuminated forest to solve that. So we use basically this extra growth to make what we call Almere 2.0. We start with a bubble diagram. This because it was born in the 70s. And they made this town, then they made this, then they grow this. And we say we just continue with that. We don't touch the existing garden cities, but we add more to that. And that would then mean that we can use to change this somehow nice but also stupid diagram of the garden cities by Howard to give that an input. Because hierarchy, I want to have more roads. Differentiation, please do, both in green as in garden cities. So I think this could be a fantastic new Howard to be imagined in the end. So this is the plan of the city. But what is happening? Where is our new part? Here they are. We don't touch the existing. Houses are 20 years old. People are just, they just got it. You can't kill that. You have to find escapes, is what we try to do. By having, say, making a new metro line and put five new garden cities in, on top of it. So here you see this line coming from Amsterdam in a tunnel, popping up in new Almere, and then sneaking through up to the end. The first city that is that will be produced is this one, in the middle of the lake. The lake is horrible, because there was a mistake in the hydrology of the IJsselmeer, this area, and they forgot one polder to repair it. So there is the water doesn't look blue, it looks almost like coffee, it's brown in that way. And it's so how to repair that? That's this 20,000 units are taking that on their shoulder. They do that with making a hole in the middle, digging it, having a hoover in it, that brings, and it's 40 meter deep, to brings all the shit into that place. And use that in the meantime for cleaning it, to construct the swamps, construct the houses in such a way that the water is clean up till it is into the hoover in that way. So this is a garden city because it loves landscape, it makes landscape in another way. Next one, here, this is the Expo of where we want to invite Amsterdammers, the first place, to do what they want, basically, and to make their other dream of what they have done. Then we go further, we come into the very center, where on the left part, OMA made this center, and that we extend with this loop and this new mirror image. I come back to that later. And end in the east part, where we try to combine agriculture with products, is what we are going to do. So these are different examples. Now let me give then deepen then two of them as they are on the production. Freeland, Oosterwold, I showed it in the Venice Biennale, is now under development. It is, say, that east part. It looks a bit like Russia in that way, but what is it going to do? We change it from an existing agriculture field to a combination, cohabitation of agriculture, intenser urban agriculture with urbanism. And we do it, and I think this is the WeGo city a little bit, but then in the shape of an environment, that you can cut, you can build what you want, but you have to take a piece of the pie. So also you have to do, in that way, pieces of the agriculture and the water element. We do that with our software that we develop in this case, so which calculates the price for an individual, but you can do that with more, and with also with specialists, and you can do it with many more, is what it wants to do. The good thing, I think, is that instead of having a suburb that's where you have only a garden that surrounds you, that you're always surrounded with farming, depending on the grain that is. But then you have to solve everything, because this has a price. The price is that you have to give space to your neighbor that goes behind you in that way, always. So the plot is surrounded by you, by openness, But you have to solve your water cleaning. I think that's also, we have to challenge each other in that way and to make something that is not harming your neighbor in that way, is what it wants to do. You do that also with electricity, and this has caused a change in Dutch law. Normally state has to provide you with electricity if you request that. In this case it's a no. It's 4,000 hectares were excluded from this constitutional act, so that in order to force our electricity companies to provide not current, but to provide service in that way and products. Here again, your urbanism comes in here at this school. You have to find and investigate this kind of products that should be there. And then, of course, urbanism or agriculture comes in. And then it's an invitation to do what you want, from small to big, from straight to round, from all kind of meanings could be addressed. And these are the first plots that are coming up. Okay, there they come next year. So one wants to live in the middle of nowhere. There's a colony of that wants to live in a kind of, yeah, in four wings, a Catholic community in that way. There is one that wants to be on a corner. There's one that loves a windmill, etc. And then, of course, how does the next generation react? You have to go around the former guy. There is no grid in this case. This is like urbanism by surprise. And I cannot draw it. I can only design the software for that, that is giving it. And that turns then gradually this into such a kind of, say, development. Or when these images are now to be imagined as such. And it's more than a collage. It's collage by you, is what it wants to say. And that where the surprise is the general part of it. So what is next? The Floriade is, of course, an invitation to get you on board. The Floriade is basically an expo in 2022 where we built this counterpart for REM. So here is the book, how we won it, and I bring you to the site. Here I go down to the lake, the very heart, and we want to extend the center with the university complex and the housing area, a university quarter. So how to do that? If on the left side is my Floriade, and on the rest side is OMA's center, then I look at the moment to my history, also my history. Well, it is very well done, let's say that. But I dream that, of course, my patron, in a way, looks back later in this way to us, in a way. So do the same, but completely dredged in green. This is the plan of that Floriade. And we use these artists basically to say, I want to be dredged in green. Yeah, what green? Ranunkel? That is kind of plants? No. The expo is about showing a lot, if not everything. So yes, how to make a building with tulips, or make one with wisteria. Or this is a great couloir in one university project. This is not a bad building. This looks also quite okay. And even under new circumstances, and there are great people that already did that in the past. So the formula of all these 1,000 lots is that you have a species, you build your buildings, and you do your exercise on ecology, and then we can have them together. And yes, then I can have concerts like this, or play volleyball in that way, or have a good training circuit in such a, or dancing down there wouldn't be bad. Sleeping in a Dutch way, or bathing in an exuberant way, a collection of site, spot, species, program, and author is what we are now intending to do and start developing in the nearby future. And then I can do with that carpet what I want. I can bend it over the highway, I can bend it over the water, and I can give this, say, handkerchief to the world as a kind of tableau vivant for this new city. 1,000 houses in that way, about 100,000 square meters of university and hotel program, that's it, that we are going to do. No offices, of course, no V&D, no shops, because that doesn't work. But my major clients are these. These are the 1,000 clients that we want to see. Here in detail, what they can do. There are about 20 betula that I need to facilitate. There are great Erikas in that way. Some of you know exactly what they are, and some of you look like this, what is this for kind of lists? But exactly, and then we order them from A till Z, from the anemone to the zenobia, so that is very clear, no discussion. My arboretum looks like this at that moment, and I make it with you in that way. So where is then Belgium coming, of course, because the pavilion of Belgium, one rule, afterwards it's a house. So I mean, the weirdest Belgian design will be inhabited by a Dutch. And the price of the selling will be, of course, combined in that way. But it will be in the B section. And they pick the Berberis as their national plant. So that fits. Spain under the S section in that way. So what kind of plant will be there? So there is this kind of composition is going to happen. These are my buildings. And so I'm not afraid of architects anymore because I cover them with plants. So there's no problem at all. Leads to this, say, skyline. This, say, boulevard. And this presentation. Here the model that some of you have seen on the exhibitions, how the existing elements are part of it, how the streets are cute, how everything is green in the widest sense. And then to discuss this with politicians and investors is now what happened and that we will take on board. But what's next with Almere? I did not talk about the existing half, because if we go from 150,000 people to 300,000 in the coming 15 years, where are the other 150? We made it possible that they could move. Why moving is important? Because you have a career in your life. You are not sure where you want to live, and you want to find alternatives. That seems to help. So at the moment, we are working on Almere 2.0, which is basically the rest of the matter, the existing stuff. And we try to, in the process to 2022, to put that already on the map with a sequence of, say, projects that are also green, hyper-green. And that is accompanied with aims. Like, so these are the aims, where everyone is sharing what are the operations of the green in that way. We show the tools that we have. Marketing. We have this marketing tool for a certain budget that we can do. We have a certain kind of green labels that we are going to apply. We have a forum that makes the collective intelligence on it, and we sell them in this kind of websites, the plots. We monitor all its presentations and its prestations. So I use the knowledge of Greater Paris now on Greater Almere in that way. So you can see that the things are continuing in its calculations as such. And then what are the first initiatives? I show some of them. In that way. So this is the way how we communicate at the moment. They pop up in that respect. This one, for instance, a small, horrible piece of Almere. And it's like, but the group of people are fantastic. It's next to the center, next to, say, Rem Koolhaas, and they want to do this. They want to turn it into a biergarten. Go for it in the coming half year. Or this one, this group, says, I have this boat, but what can we do with this? So what we simply do now is connect it with the environment. Or this famous street that I started it. This is called the Bird Street. Where are they? So we could convince the majority, I mean one person doesn't like it, to have a new facade, a new isolation that can cover more birds and that wants them have them in. And the hospital is settling also in these old glass houses. And actually, that's a good idea. I hate hospitals as they are now. I love your pyjama gardens in your old hospital in the Ensanche, which is one of the most beautiful gardens with all these people walking outside. This is our version in the end that we are so inspired by Barcelona. So, and then this, of course, this is a stupid park that we connect with the outskirts. That's too complicated for you because it's a very specific film about this horses that go through the polders at the moment. And we add, with Philips, we make a specific lamp so that you can have an LED appearance over the city in that way. And of course our station, which looks, I keep it like this, like this rack, but I simply bend it and use it as a welcoming device for the station. And I could convince, say, the mayor to live on the roof of the town hall so that she is also participating in this operation. And that are a sequence of elements which I would like to have ready before the Floriade is starting, and where indeed we infiltrate that specific city, Almere, with like a green attack as such, and that somehow makes it more special, more specific, and hopefully much more interesting than all kind of other countries. I go further in urbanism. Yeah, I take you more. It's a hard lesson today. So about, and I, on special request, it's a special day today. That's Norwegian day, understood. So there's a how to do it in Oslo. When you fly Swiss or whatever, you see this normally in it, which is funny. What what happened in Oslo and in Norway is what it wants. Even the Scandinavian travelers are getting more proud on what has been done over there. It was a farmer's society maybe 20 years ago. Oil came there and huppakee, next phase on an environment. So what can you do with that? So here the center with a beautiful, well, half beautiful opera. And the backside is really ugly. And it's how to treat that. So they have invited first architects to make blocks. Only blocks. Blocks. Why blocks? I mean, do it only in Barcelona, I would say, and not in the rest of the planet. And so we try to change that into another direction for a certain aim. Namely, that every block would have two entrances, one at the central station, and I will show you later, and one to the fjord, was the idea. And then, by making the slices, I can make more, say, perspectives, and more streets between the old and the new in that way. So here you see the plan, how we worked on it with the master plan, and showing the different slices, how we worked on the differentiation and the different architecture in it. Again, from say Swiss composition to a wilder composition, how that was kind of imagined. This has been accompanied with complex rules. The legal system in Norway is quite okay, it's of course very good, but it's a little bit stiff, I would say. So how to adopt that? We had to add this kind of volumes. How to translate drawings into Norwegian words was an interesting composition so that this could then happen. We accompanied that with a catalogue of potential forms, but the interesting comes in this diagram. Because if I do a huge block, then I block the view of the neighbor, or the view of the, or the light of the neighbor. So this correlation between the different elements says something about the ground price of any shape that would come across, and the programming that's inside. So we made a software with them to with this kind of components. When you would make a block, you put it there, then it calculates basically all those kind of parameters and makes then in the end the price of that block. That helped the client to work on it, and that lead ultimately to this composition as such. And now it's there. And here you can walk, like even better than in Zurich. I can walk from the station immediately into the houses. I can pass by the different architecture, go into the different streets. Some of them are not so nice, and others are better in that way, to be honest. And go to the passages that are in between, and every block is doing it. And end, of course, with the boulevard. Now the tunnel is all underneath there. It becomes something. Every building is having a good shop or a good restaurant to that place, and it shows itself together on the sea. And now I'm happy when I take a boat from Amsterdam, then I see on the shores of Oslo, like Eastern Island, somehow something nice appearing. And I'm aware this took, the discussion of niceness was huge in Oslo. There were people that were against it, and there were others that loved it in as such. But let me bring you to some of the examples inside, to bring it to architecture, the consequences of architecture at that moment. Because if this is the we made this building, the DNB Nor, the Norske Bank, where at the moment that this was happening, this at that bang, it fell down, and this was say our client at that moment. This were his colleagues, and some of his colleagues, they had to jump. So what to do in that case? After many discussions to get the bank out of the city and put it here, was also done to do it in kind of, it should be a transparent bank. So that means basically three buildings that we do with three different signatures, three different selling objectives that were like collectively the three sisters together and would take a piece of the padding, I would say. The central bank had, because that should be longer there, we developed on a thick monster. Thick because it needed quite some program. And the discussion was there, what do you do with that? And we had, I think this moment was the nicest one. When we talked with the owners of the bank and the directors and to say, yeah, what do you want? How do you collaborate? And they said, we want to control each other. I said, how do you control each other? Yeah, we want to be transparent. Yeah, does that work only? Yes, but how to do that? How do pilots doing it? So we could imagine a cockpit system that you would work with three persons and that you would move during the time collaborating. The bank is based on the cockpit as such. And then we had a tool to negotiate with the city about the view lines, with the arcade and the passage, with the specific ecological components, with the deep sun and the low sun angles to make a deeper building, with having, say, craters for the smokers and for the to walk and around to have the special programs. Yes, even the boarding room and even the dealing room should be then in the building, and that should be combined with this route, this interior route, glass pixels that would connect from the bottom to the top and back again, and the same with the outside. Then we would have like a facade that is explained like that in black and in white, the two routes, and it would cause at that moment every floor would be different, and every floor had an identity. And in the end, you would enter here, go further, take the route up, and go further through the building and walk with you for a moment through the dealing room. Stairs that bring you further, every office is connected to that route, ultimately to the top where you have a good view. A rock in the center of this enterprise, and that has no shape in that way. It is a result of the actions, and that is kind of celebrated by that. And now it's there, you can walk there, it's hard to get in. Here the smokers, how they can run, how the passage is there with the cockpits, how we go further and be inside the building. And I take the same pictures that I had before, how it's now there, made with Norwegian carpenters, Norwegian, everything is Norwegian. That's how it is. There is not such an interest in the foreigners, but where every place is somehow connected to this collective space. And then I can look back and up to see people or to go further on this route, and I witness even the dealing room in a specific way. Yes, this would be my spot with views to the others, and how I then can walk further with the director and over this landscape that is very domestic. I love it in a way how that has been developed up to the ceiling, to the top, where we have this kind of view collectively over the fjord. And that is, I think, the explanation of the center part of this this element. What is next in Oslo? I could wonder after done this. So one thing is that this was in the newspapers to start with, and so it became with the opera and other buildings as a symbol of the quantum leap of the country. It became the background of the news at that moment. It won some awards in that way. It was ahead of the MIPIM. It became say pieces in Wall Street Journal and different places. It was celebrated by that. That was nice after all the discussions and all the vulnerabilities that are there. And yes, it is a picture point at that moment in that spot. So what we then got out of it is a discussion on the metropolitan area, Oslo Met, and to somehow copy the barcode. How? And by activating the metronet and the extensions of the metronet of the city. This becomes nice now, because how can you do that? The simple law, how can you make a law of 200 meters, 300 meters radius that needs a certain density, and that how to calculate that, and how to do that in a way that everybody would love that. So here I show you Lusaker, stop. No one knows Lusaker, yeah, some. But that's what can you do there at that moment, is what it says. So here's the site of Lusaker. And what is the beauty of Lusaker is actually the river. So put all that density to make that river better, to clean the river bed and to turn it into a kind of beautiful snake, is what this project is going to do. Or Ruin in that moment, somewhere at the east. It's very ugly in Ruin. It is basically a shopping center that doesn't function very well and needs a re-investigation. This station can do that, can help you that, with to turn it into a park with a surrounding program. Or Os. Os is an agro-community in the fields, this next station, and also here, to surround the fields with this intensity would be great. And some of you know Vigeland. I mean, I love it. It is one of the nicest sculptures. Somehow it's horrendous. It's a bit scary, this element. But even we suggest that also Vigeland should help with the six towers that somehow are copies of that sculptures in that moment. And then, yes, of course, this whole area in the center should be a little bit like Paris with extra floor. And yes, around the palace, I can imagine the stop with more, say, towers that guard the queen and the king in a nice way. And then end up, of course, with the boardwalk. An easy project to do that, and end with Moss. If we do the coastline of Bjorvika, then maybe in the far end, the ultimate southern part, we should demonstrate and make a nice place out of it that you would like to sit, to use the program, to sit and have a good smoke and drink, to have a view over Europe, is what this project wants to do. Then we try to make a scenography. 50 different stations, 50 different neighborhoods. I think that would be wonderful to develop with 50 different, entrepreneurs and authors is what this is going to take. Okay, now, maybe enough of urbanism as such. I give you a scoop. Because I want to take you to a difficult but nice example, which is called Mannheim. Where is Mannheim? You would know. Mannheim is actually the center of Europe. They didn't know it yet, but it is on the crossing of from these two major high-speed railways in the Mannheim, of course, is in the middle of nowhere because it's like flooded with suburbanism everywhere, with Heidelberg and whatever, Mutterstadt and Wiesbaden and Ludwigshafen, all the places you don't want to be. And what to do then? Heidelberg, so Mannheim, this is 90% of Mannheim looks like this. So it's quite American somehow. If I continue, then this is all the images of Mannheim. But these are the floor plan. So what is next? And here, US is going to help. Because they have five old barracks in Mannheim. Not only there, also Heidelberg, Kaiserslautern, Hamburg, and so weiter. So what to do with that? Merkel needs to pay the Americans for it. How much does a caserne cost? No price. Americans are very clever. They know when there is better density or how the value is. So the negotiations between the two governments is like has to be helped by urbanists. Because we can show how much density is doable. We can tweak it. We can also, there are many tricks to play with it. And from the other side, say the SOMs are helping the Americans to beat us. So this is a battle of the urbanists, is what's happening. So we take Manhattan, we take Mannheim, and then we take Manhattan, but to make it further. So I give you an example of Benjamin Franklin. Benjamin Franklin looks like that. So you see a sea of barracks at that moment. And you have the highest amount of sport fields in this place, the highest amount of barbecue plots, the highest amount of zebra paths. It's very, very American in that way. So it's very special in Europe to do that. Then it has a similar kind of housing everywhere. It has, of course, giant parking plots. So what can we do? So we made this kind of, like in Paris and like in Bordeaux, what should be the aim? So the first thing is that it should be remarkable. Because in Germany, I don't know where I am. So where are the highlights of Middle Europe is the question in this case. The second element, it needs to be green. That's so obvious. But anyway, the green country could be nice to reconquer that. And you can see here the plans. So we made a scenography that starts now to change, to make me beautiful and to do it like that, or in that way, and to show every place to have a new landscape architecture involved. Next question is the wall project, the Anbindung, the connection. So we make, of course, connections, but we celebrate. I do think that's some people think that the wall between East and West Berlin is a bit a pity that it went, for many reasons. Nostalgia, whatever, remarkability. I don't say that we should rebuild the wall, but I want to make a zone somehow that to make this, to stage Benjamin Franklin before it's forgotten. So he make his ring park that somehow where you have the best, say, running field of the site. And the next project, we want to open the site. This is fascinating. So like Damien Hirst, we try now to open these blocks. I have one owner, which is very easy to do. So that's wonderful. There's not an opportunity before that I can cut like a scissor two lines through these whole blocks in that way. And that forms the Europa Achse, of course, of this operation. So it's just like I said, okay, over and out is what it wants to say. And we start up again in this Freiland, in this Freeland that I will show you in a minute. So here you see how the existing is cut, and then we have a nice field and a nice pond. And of course, I want to not kill the buildings. I think it would be good to develop that and to turn it. So we develop with all the investors, about 40 investors, a different, say, catalog from nothing to coloring to green to a new facade to cutting the roof to adding stuff. My favorite, and I will show you, the Trümmer Hill, the stuff that we bring together in one hill again, the individualizing part, the ruin, the boxes, the artists, the Pompeii in that way. And then we start to work with freedom. So to negotiate with all these developers, all these new house owners, how can we deal with that? And these are the plots. This is the map of the plots that we now made. And you can do this, or you can do this, or you can do this. You can do that in this way, add to that and to that. So we work in a dialogue to get all these examples on the site in different, say, organizational groups. And then, of course, it has to be done in phases. You can see it here, how that will be done in the near future. And gradually, we have this landscape over there. From here to there, to there, to there is what it's going to be in the nearby future. And somehow, with these plots, with this interpretation, this, say, inhabitation, I do hope that we can make a new Freiland at that way. And what's the next? Let me go to the center for a moment. So where is the center? There is no center. No, that's true. So let's make one in this plot. I take you to the environment. Look how insane this is. This is a fascinating environment with a church. This must be the center in the place. Of course, more children are there. So okay, let's do it there. So we give some targets again, what the center should be. And let me get some of them in that way. We want to connect it. So here, the Europa axis cuts through the whole, these are all the lines that are connected, but the Europa axis is a special one that cuts through all these buildings, also in our very heart, that have all these different, say, addresses, and that we treat like that. We show it, they're clearly cut, we add that into our pavement, and we give information of the cuts that's over there, that goes in this, say, transaction from the north to the south. We make a base, like here, for the parking and all the elements, and we put, say, a plaza on top, okay, where we dip down to the church so that it can survive. Then we make reuse the facade buildings that surround it with a different program, and that we, with a library, with a different functions in it, so that you have a good plaza. And then we add the hill. We needed more program that's there, 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 and if I use it in a good way, then at a certain moment, wow. And I cover it with all the shit that is there, then I have a cool hill that's like this. And that, ooh, this was a problem. One minute. Yeah, there it is. So, there, say, this hill. Give me a minute. Overworked.
You can also use this.
Yeah, but it's there it is. And how, say, the different, say, components are cut out of it, and how we add new housing around it, how we give that also an address, how we have echoes of different, say, laws that lead ultimately in this kind of treatment of this hill, and makes it a collective viewing point of it. We used basically the supermarkets for that, the Lidl's. Didn't I start with Lidl's? Here is my Lidl, in that way, that is now coming to, and then we surround it with density. So we make four towers that surround this, and that are connected to that, and that they have a certain maximum height. And we discussed what kind of family we would like to do. So initially we proposed all the heads of the generals of Germany to have them over there, and to compensate a little bit what happened in the US. But they didn't like, and then, no, that was not good. Maybe it should be like love in that way. And they said, no. And we ended up with home. And I think actually it's very good, because this is makeable at that moment, with all the laws that are there, that in this case. And so it has one type of facade, it has a different illumination, and it has this kind of, say, außenräume, the outer rooms that are needed. So what does it bring? So I give you some perspectives. Here, how now the center is going to be there, with home that surrounds the hill and the plaza. How the Europa axe is cutting through it, and going through the hill to the destination. How we can walk now in the park to the hill and go over it, go inside, go outside again, see the church with its deepened and sunk into Europe, in that way, take the bridge and go further over the Europa axe to an infinite component as such. So here's some views over the hill. When I'm on the top, I can look to the Europa axe, but of course I can see with H-O-M-E what is happening over there. And then I go further from the distance. Yes, now, from the highway, from Frankfurt to Basel, there is one place in Europe where you can be at home, and that's in Mannheim, in the nearby future. So these are the plans of that site, with the basement, the extensions, the different Geschosse, the floors in that way, up from the bottom to the top. And how the sections, in a way, go through it in the different elements, just to show you that it's there and that it's coming. And then, yes, of course, we have a good plaza. Of course, we have a hill that loves the old buildings and it goes over it and it gives you a view over the Europa Achse into the infinity as such. And that loves the church, that caresses it in a kind of sunken matter in that way. And then here, how it's now discussed with the model, simply there, with the H, the O, the M, the E, and that forms this composition now into this landscapes. Am I finished now? I have to develop it with a German logic. So we have to do it with, because this is not the Netherlands, so I have to make simply standard towers like this. And then you copy them. No, I understand it. And then you have 10% of my budget to connect them in that way, is how it is going to work. And I can make, put the connection there, no problem. Split it over there, no problem. Hang it over there, no problem. And cut it like this. So then we make an H, which is herausfordernd, hübsch, in that way. With this tower, this plants, this development as it is now, and now it's there. And the O, originel, ecologisch, economisch, I don't care. Here it is, and how it is like positioned in itself, with all the logics behind it. And it counts also for the M, which is Mannheim, natürlich, or monumental, or the MVRDV, or the merkwürdig. But that is then what it has on its mind. And then we end with the A, who is energetisch, and it looks like this in the end. So yes, it's doable. Even under German conditions, you can make a next step on that. And then, of course, this should not be formal. I am aware you will going to say that to me afterwards, but this is, so I love this. This moment that people are going to inhabit the Buchstaben, the letters, in that way. So we made a technique that allows now for a hyper, say, adaptation process, so that this becomes gradually with all the elements into something like that. And then I think we do something more. You inhabit it, this kind of home. And what is next? I show you the new inhabitants. You're our client in that way. But these are the new inhabitants, to be honest. With 30% of my neighborhood will be done with these. And it was, of course, a huge decision. So how to do that? So the first have come in that place. Here you see it happening. And I was like shocked seeing these posters. Got that on one hand, that I was welcoming these people in that way. And actually, I'm very proud on it. I think the Netherlands was not as good as Germany in this case. I think it's stupid what they do at the moment with Merkel. I'm not a CDU. I'm completely socialist. But in this case, I think this was deserves attention. So my project is somehow helping, hopefully, her in this kind of willkommen to be zu Hause. You are at home, is what it wants to say. And yes, we calculate now with how much would be now here in terms of like what we in emptiness and in development. How many people will stay? How many will go to Hamburg or back to other countries is this project about? This is also the rationale that we are dealing with it and that we have to defend to the 2023. And that with that, I'm now looking indeed, there are activities going on these places that are, and we start the construction in the end of this year of these different enterprises. That is urbanism, ladies and gentlemen. I do hope that is a kind of jumping play from politics towards logics at that moment. From, say, making something remarkable out of every place that we can do and that we can turn into something like beautiful as such. Yes, we need urbanists. And I do hope that that we, with our architecture, we can contribute in a certain kind of urbanistic spirit. And I hope to apply that, of course, on more sites. But that I want to show you next time. I thank you very much for your attention for this moment. You see that it was by number 5, so 6 till 8, that's the next time.
So we'll find out what's next time.
Yes, we're welcome to get. It's always good to not finalize your lecture, because then there is a curiosity for the next one. If I kill myself with my own logics, which is of course the aim. Any questions do you have?
I think they might have questions. Does anybody have any questions for Winy?
I don't think they want.
They don't want to know. They're waiting for the next lecture.
It's normal in YAC, no? Not to ask questions. Is that
Does anybody want to ask what's in the Beijing presentation? What's next?
Well, Beijing is a wonderful story about Tiananmen Square, because of course I didn't talk about Asia. I only talked about Europe in that way. And I didn't talk about the copy act that's going to happen. So you could see that in Beijing, but that's what actually is now under production in next to that plaza. So it is indeed a nice follow-up, but that's only when people request that.
Any questions?
Any questions?
Drinks, maybe?
Drinks, then. Well, I'd like to...
Thank you so much, Winy. I know I've asked you to speak about cities, and then he SMS'd back, do you mean urbanism? I didn't mean urbanism, I meant cities, and definitely... The thing is that cities are a combination of different kind of levels of design and performance. And you have been showing that in all your projects. I mean, there are times that you need to deal with infrastructure, other times that you need to deal with convincing decision makers, others that they need to include also like social participation and people deciding what they want to have there. So it is becoming much more complex, although I have to note down that I think that with the tools that we have available, it's becoming much more easy to start integrating more agents in this complex process. So my question would be, what are the tools that you see that they would facilitate urban planning and design, and how should we educate people in order to use them, or in order to do the next step into the urban scale?
I'm a bit surprised that you didn't see the tools in this presentation, but I understand your question is very educational and rhetoric, so I accept that. Yes, so to make a summary of the tools that maybe I've shown in this amount of things. Yes, we need to have, our laws, to start with that, our tools. How many laws do we want to have in our cities? Which one can we get rid of because of certain, they are too redundant? Which one do I respect even more? Not harm my neighbor, as I thought in our Freeland exercise. These laws became more apparent at the moment that you extremize certain kind of thoughts. So that was in a moment that you have complete freedom, immediately I re-question what laws I really need in that way. So that was, I think, one tool to work with my lawyer on that exercise. The other tool that I would like to, and that's a very obvious one, because that is of course our computational potential. That's what you are also working on. I think I could never build Bjorvika without that, because it helped to negotiate about the ground price in the end. It's very functional, I'm aware. You are looking more to the theoretical level, how all these tools maybe come together, and I respect that. But I give you the ingredients of the different tools that in urbanism is needed. But also the tools of communication, simply these diagrams that are, you can say, yeah, they are silly, they're obvious, they're one-liners. Not completely. They have a consequence is what I wanted to show, especially in the Bordeaux project, where simply this were intimacy, and everyone loved it. Yes, and the villa intime was, and the consequences were huge in that respect to get that done. Or say the love of plants in that way. These are also tools. So urbanists and architects need to learn about plants much more. You had a very funny tradition, of course, in Barcelona, that the architects were also the landscape architects. In the Netherlands, it's very separated in that way. So we have to assemble that in a way to convince also that message to it. And it became a tool at that moment to convey, say, to use, in this case, the Expo for making a new neighborhood that is somehow contributing or acts as a library in the end, not only for Almere, but also for the whole city. So these are fragments. These are different tools that are there that are shown in this in this PowerPoints as such. And it's correct that it would be good to theorize on that. And maybe that's this is the place to do it, to make the good list and the, what is the relationship between those elements, because that's your question, I guess. And that is, and I avoided that, or I didn't make any theoretical project on that yet. That's true. Again, I said one glimpse that maybe in the fall when we start both in Colombia, IIT, as in Delft, on this hyper parameterized exercise, putting everything together, then I can get glimpses of it. Then I know if I want to have wolves in my city, how much food I need, how much path I need, what kind of density it allows for, how much mosquitoes I hate with that, how many windows I need in it. So just to give one hierarchy in that parameterization. The problem, of course, is with complex, say, software, is that no one is using it, or that it doesn't become clear in as such. And we have to work with many city planners that are in GIS very advanced, but in visualization very poor. That in only SketchUp in every society at the moment, which is like the most stupid program that exists in that way. So how to train that? So training is also part of our activities in that way, to make that software somewhere applicable. And am I then taught as a teacher? Not yet. So it's also, so there is, yeah, the urbanist is very generalistic, even more than the architect in that way. And that in a society of specialists, how to defend then the role of this specialist, the urbanist that can do that, how to show that there is a power in the urbanism. I don't know, please tell me or criticize me if I show these plans, which are sequences. These are not realized elements yet. And you would have come maybe tonight for these sexy images of the market hall of the Chanel store. I didn't show them tonight. But I hope that it communicated. So I need also your comments on it, how to improve that. And is it indeed then an urbanism that makes things remarkable? And that goes beyond, say, Speer and the Danish. Does it go in that way to something that helps Europe on the map to specialize in each other? Is it clear enough, or is it over clear? So please comment me on that, because that's your question also, if you talk about all the systems that cityscapes need to imagine. It's true that I didn't talk about the city. And that's fair. I didn't want to, because I don't know what the city is. I love diversity. I love even biodiversity in that sense. I do hope that somehow we can create more differentiated cities than ever. I remember that we had once a talk on Poblenau, what was it, Bentidos Arroba, in that way, and that we had to. We suggested to Asubio to make more quadras, more blocks, to enlarge the ensanche, and he said, no, I need to have something different in that way. I still regret that, to be honest. And it's, with all the respect that you have been filling in, that Bendidos Arroba, it is, I think, maybe you wanted to have something from another planet, because you thought that would be better to compete. I doubt it. I think it would be, and now with your quadras, your super quadras, I think that's a fantastic project that somehow wants to emphasize that quality in that way. Should it go over the mountains to Tarragona or going further in that way? I don't know. We can test it in that way if you like. So there's should it, where does it end? Or what is the assimilation of this region in that way? And you need the power of the metropolitan area is very important in the future in Catalonia, because Barcelona itself is so cute and small. And you need the others to some discuss on the wider coherence. A project that sometimes is happening, but how to make that possible? I mean, guys, if you want to make the best next station somewhere in Tarragona or in Sitges, then you have to plead for this kind of coherence. So I should not do that. I'm just like a visitor that passes by and is a bit like, and see what's happening when not having a quality team since 10 years in this place. I see mayors that did something, and some that are silent and that now readdress it. I see roles of you guys which are endlessly trying to repeat on that. So my way is only to help that a little bit and to put that stronger to the agenda. Can you do that? I mean, I'm fine that you go independent. I don't care. But it's like, it's more important is that you make, maybe it helps even to become more specific from that point. It's very delicate that you're going to do that. And at the moment we are working with a Scottish, another group, same as you, that wanted to be also independent and to think what their urbanism could be to make their country in that way more remarkable in that way. So somehow the threat of independence can help also to make it more special in that way and to think about it. I hope that you use that or misuse that or abuse that momentum in a way to give architecture a more clearer platform in that way and to defend that, say, the IAAC becomes, then you need an you in it, not advanced urbanism, that program is then also shown on this part, that you fulfill the necessities of your program. You're financed by the Catalan government so that you do 50% on that attack, on that operation to make the most remarkable, I almost say province in co-federal Europe. Within Europe, and that and the rest you do the theoretical approach. Okay, that's fair. And to do that, did I give an answer or did I give an exposé in that way? A question there.
Yeah, we have one last question.
Just quickly, there's a tendency for cities, or the trend now, to view or look at cities through data, or reduce it to data. So what about those urban phenomena that cannot be explained by data? What is your approach to start to capture or instigate or detect the changes that would make up the composition of the urban fabric, for instance?
Okay, first counter proposition, everything is can turn into data. Every, sensitive issue can do post-scripted. Don't worry. If you say that, want to give space for individuality, that could be one of the undatified elements, I can guarantee you that if you want to make the maximum diversity, that we can script that and that we can turn it into a reasonable sequence. In order to guarantee your desire for having diversity, I need to help you basically with that kind of data, with this kind of scripting, in order to guarantee that your neighbor is not copying you in that way. Unless you say, no, actually, it's fine to copy. So we change one element in that data system to allow for that. So I want to force you or to provoke you a little bit in that, because every time I go to southern places, then you ask the same question. Why? You come from the north, so everything is datified. But in this case, in our country, we do. We care about emotion. We care about the unknown, and which is fair. I don't say you're wrong. And I love emotion, and I think when I was talking with a student work in Porosity about, I gave first the word to students to look what kind of emotions could be done, could be found, and then to compare them, and then to give them a place. That's what I wanted to illustrate, that ultimately I could post-script then even emotions in that way. I cannot prescript, I'm aware. That's fair in that way. So I can never prescript the unknown. Also, and I'm curious that we share, I hope, in that way to work with the unknown. But how to position the unknown is more an interesting part. So how can I do that in Mannheim, in this place? I will do that differently if I would have done the 20,000 arroba in that sense, to position that unknown in itself. Yes, we have to do that. If I would be a dean, which will never be in my life, don't worry, but then I would give also like 15% of the budget to the unknown, not to pre-give that to a kind of program or to the curriculum, because you don't know what you can expect of these people, and every initiative can be fantastic in that way. So there are tools to position the unknown in that way. That's what I wanted to say. Even if it's unknown in that way, somehow we have to find a way. If I want to do with experimentation, which you want to defend also, or anyway, this is my interpretation of what you say. Yeah, experimentation is one of the most vulnerable parts of our society. At the moment that everyone is talking about limited budget and we're talking about fear, basically, safety issues, there's no money left for experimentation. Yeah, and exactly at that moment, I have to make a logic for experimentation. I have to defend to our ministers to say, why is experimentation good? How much money do I need for that experimentation in order to facilitate exactly your question, your unknown? So I hope that I am aggressive enough now for your question to give a kind of new balance of that meaning, to deepen that, and not to give it to architects that say only, oh, mythical, should be transparent. Why? Can you give me one argument? I mean, there is culture of both the unique, the authentic, and the culture of to be new in that way sometimes kills also our architecture. There are not so many architects that are really new. And there are maybe 1% that has somehow come up and that gave something new. We have to do it, we have to facilitate that, but the 99% should not suffer from that kind of heroism that you are painting. So some kind of remarks I'm giving to you that surround your question, that enlarges a little bit that scope before I'm dredged into this horrible world of the sensitive and the how do you call that kind of the vagueness. I hate vagueness. That doesn't help at all in the end, and especially not in urbanism, because that is the artistic is fantastic. But what art is the best in these days? Is conceptual art not the best in that way? And the conceptual artists somehow give messages to the planet that are very clear in that way, but they are understandable, but also very deep in that way. So I defend a specific zone in the art world, and the rest, I don't care at that moment to see it. I think we have to be much more strong in our argumentation. We have to be very clear and very, because there are so many people. So how to, if you add some vagueness in this soup that we call our cities, that's the problem with the cities in that way. Man, you are drowned. Never, no one will anywhere listen to you. And because there is no message in it, and there is no desire to deal with it or to innovate on it, exactly at the same point that you want to do. So I hope that you can find some techniques to make this one sentence that you do, one question, to deepen that. So I challenge you for that, and I hope to give you, that you write me an email on this, or that you say it now and loudly, or never.
Do you want to say it?
Okay, that's fair. That's now you illustrated.
I'm not against the data. I'm just saying that I
no. So I give you some examples in that way, and it's indeed not one algorithm. There are much more, and it's quite a deep algorithm. Though I you have seen our algorithm about Hertzberger, who wanted to have this kind of diversity. It's a very easy algorithm in the end. So if you want to play like Hertzberger, I can give you the algorithm, and then you can make buildings like Hertzberger. So, you know, you could, what was an exercise, and at the moment with copy-paste we are doing that more, how to behave like Sejima, and how to show that. It's actually quite a simple algorithm in that way. I'm provoking, I know. I didn't try Miralles yet, but that's a harder one. Maybe that's fair in that case to do it. But you're right. I can see. So it's good to illustrate this. This is a conversation. In that respect.
So what do you want to say? I wanted to invite you to have the conversation in front of a beer, but before so, can I invite everyone to thank Winnie once again for the wonderful lecture of this evening.